afternoon, everyone. My name is Paul, and I am a nerd, and you are lucky enough to be here for our Tabs3 virtual user group meeting for, gosh, Mary Jo, March? April? May? I think it's March. It feels kind of like February or January, but we have it on good authority that come next week and the week after, it's going to feel more like March and April. So here we are in the March 2019 Tabs virtual user group meeting from Attorney Computer Systems, where today we will be talking about doing cost accounting in general ledger, something that's at least the ability to have it automatically reconcile or have it reconcile as new in version 19. Mary Jo will take that topic. And I'm going to talk about the new EFT flag in accounts payable. And so now, without any further ado, I'm going to press all the right buttons that are going to get me to a point where I can go into general ledger so that Mary Jo can talk about the cost accounting in general ledger.
Okay, so we've always been able to add costs to tabs and through AP and all of those things. But what would happen is we would always have a hard time reconciling those things. Every time we would put a cost in tabs or AP and, you know, for an advance for a client, and we build the client for it and, you know, put it over to a cost account into GL, and, you know, then eventually, hopefully that client would pay for that advance and then it would reconcile itself out. And we wanted to, you know, you're never going to get to zero on that account because you're always going to be fronting money and advancing money for clients' costs. And you're going to be constantly getting payments in over time. But we want a way to be able to say that, well, Tabs thinks that this amount is due for advances for all these clients, A, B, C, D, E, F. And General Ledger says that we have that same balance due for our client cost advances. That's what we're talking about to reconcile client cost advance, that Tabs matches our General Ledger account at all times. And it would get really difficult to do that because if you write off an expense in Tabs after you've billed it to through accounts payable and it went to GL, it wouldn't do that. You'd have to make a special journal entry to take it out of that particular account and move it out of that client cost advance, because write-offs don't post automatically to the general ledger, and neither would payment adjustments or any kinds of things like that that would affect that account. We have to be very careful when we adjust things that have advances in it so that we can carry that over and do that. Well, in version 19, we do have the ability to reconcile those accounts as to what's been paid and what hasn't. And we still have to be careful if we write off or if we do certain things in tabs that affect client cost advance, but this tool will help us a little bit better. So the first thing that we need to do is we need to have a client cost advance account set up in our chart of accounts. So when we're in GL and we have that account set up in here for client cost advance, so here's one up here, it does need to be an asset account for this to work. Now, I see a lot of times some firms will have this down as an expense account or something else, and it does not work when we have that there. We need to have the client cost advance account set up as an asset account. When we double click that account, if you've already got one, we want to make sure that this box is checked that says advanced client cost account, that this is that account that we're going to use for that purpose. And so we're checking that box. If you already have one that exists, all you have to do is open it. As long as it's an asset account, you can change it. And it may be named something else, that's fine, but we want to check this box. And it must be an asset account. If you have one that's a different type of an account, you're going to want to add a new one, and you're going to want to move that balance up here, and you're going to want to change your integration so that that goes over there. But we'll get to that part too. So for all these pieces to work, for this report to come out in our general ledger, we need to have the client cost advance account set up as an asset account and the box checked. Once that is done, we also need to make sure that our integration in Tabs 3 is set up to also go to that account. So when we are in, let me move down on my screen here. While my screen is too big, let me scroll down there. Okay, there's tabs. I got it. Okay, so if we get into tabs, we're going to get out of that, and we're going to go over here. We're in sample data, so we just got to get over here. We are going to go into our integration settings for GL. So let me get up to the top here, and we're going to go to our maintenance. We are going to go to our integration and to GL integration setup. So the second key the second piece of the puzzle here that we need is in our configuring of our payment integration, we need to make sure that our costs are going into a client cost advance account. So our advances have to go to that same GL account that we just checked that said that's our client cost advance account. So that is key right here. This is our other expenses. This is our copies, postage, and whatever. Those can go to an expense income account. That's fine. But anything that's a client cost advance that comes in as a payment, it's going to go over to that account and it's going to hit that. So when a payment comes in, it'll post it there. So that's piece number two. The third piece of the puzzle that we need to do is in accounts payable, every time we enter an advance, we need to make sure that that advance is also hitting that account. So when we are in here for our invoice manual checks, we need to make sure that on the general ledger tab, when we're writing out an invoice to a court, let me get over here to do like $100, that this general ledger screen here is set up to also go to that client cost advance account. And all costs that are advanced need to be entered through accounts payable. We can't just go into tabs and manually enter it in tabs, or we can't go into general ledger and just do a journal entry and have that show up on this report that we're going to do. It must be entered through accounts payable. And then when that third screen pops up, you know, for the client cost screen, that's when we're going to bill the client is through accounts payable. So, whoops, I didn't put in an amount there. Let me get an amount in this. So $100, we'll save it. And you also now in accounts payable, just as a side note, with a client cost advance account, you can set it to only pop that third window to bill a client when you choose this 1210 account. There's a setting here in accounts payable for you to do that. So if you, you know, a lot of times that third screen pops, you know, every time you write an invoice in any version prior to 19. And if you have not set that to just say only pop if it's the 1210 account in my example, the client cost account. But if you set it that way, the only time that third window will pop is when you use that account, which is nice. You don't have to just close it when you don't want to use it. So this is on there. We're going to go ahead and save. When this third window pops, this is where I would go ahead and bill the client from accounts payable. That's the third key. It has to be from accounts payable that we enter everything in that we're billing the client. The payments need to come in through tabs and going to that account in GL, and the account in GL must be set up as that client cost advance account. When all three of those things are in place and we have that all done, then when we are in our GL, let me get out of this, there is a report that we can run. Let me get out of all of that, sorry. My screen's a little larger than I can see. Should just go into full screen. That would probably be a best bet. Let me get out of that, close all those. We are going to get back into GL. And over here, we've got an advanced client cost report. Now, if you don't have that over here in your recent actions, we were just in it earlier today to set this up. But if you don't have it here, you can search for it in your actions, or if you go under your reports, it's right here at the top, advanced client cost report. So you can get into that report. This just runs it. You don't have any parameters that you pick. It's just going to run it, and it's going to tell you, I'm going to pin this over to the side so we can see this a little bit better. And then it's going to tell us, let me scroll over. I got to get this full screen. There we go. Now I can see the whole screen. Oh, my goodness. Oh, I love computers, right, Paul? All right, Tabs3 advances due. So this is what's currently due to us. Our Tabs3 WIP advances that are coming in, those are the work in process. So anything that we had that we had put on an invoice and billed the client, but they have not paid yet, or we have not billed the client yet for it, still in WIP. Any of the unposted unpaid invoices are in there, and any unposted checks. So it's going to take into account all of those things and tell you what that balance should be. Then it's going to look at the balance in the 1210 account and tell you what it thinks it should be. And in this example, in my sample data, I have a discrepancy. Something happened that is different in here. So if you want to look at some information regarding discrepancies of where you can start to look for where those are, there's a nice little article here that you can go into in knowledge base. But most of the time, these things are happening when we don't follow those rules. We don't enter the cost directly through AP. We've just manually put a cost into tabs without going through accounts payable. Or maybe we wrote off one of those client cost advance, or we wrote it down, or wrote it up, or any of those kinds of things that we've changed it manually in tabs, it's going to cause a discrepancy, and it's going to flag it immediately. so that you know, oh, something's wrong, what did I do? And you'll be able to go find that right away. So it's going to calculate everything out for you so you can go look at what it should be and then what it actually is saying in the GL of what it thinks it is. And then you can make any journal entries or things that you need to fix that discrepancy if needed. This article is really good. It's going to give you some information totally on how to fix those things, what to look for, all of that. But this tool, we've never had it before where we can just kind of have that option to look at these advances in a different way and to help us to reconcile them instead of trying to figure this out on our own. Where do I look? What do I do? Where am I off? You know, what's happened? So hopefully that helps and you'll be able to balance those a little easier. Well,
awesome. Thank you, Mary Jo. Mm-hmm. Mine's a little easier. I always get the easy topics. Why is that, Mary Jo? I'm going to talk about let me get into accounts payable. Sorry. I'm going to talk about the new EFT switch. Now, for anybody who's been around since before version 19, you know that doing EFTs in accounts payable was kind of a pain because you needed to either have a check number and there was a time when that check number had to be unique, and so we even had come up with workarounds to have it automatically number your EFTs with fake check numbers. So that particular problem was solved a little while ago, but we've solved all of the problem by simply adding an EFT switch here. Okay? It used to be just that there was a checkbox where you could say, this is a manual check. And the assumption was it was either a manual check or a check that was generated by the system. And therefore, if it was a manual check, it gave you a chance to enter the check number because you had already written the check out. Or if it wasn't a manual check, it would wait until it printed the check, and then it would put that check number in there for you. EFTs were not considered at that point. And so really, all we've done is added this ability here to say that something is an EFT. And Mary Jo, you're done with this one. So I'm just going to go ahead and make a new entry here. And I'm going to go ahead and put it a check to the clerk of courts. For $100, the clerk's through EFT, but I guess we do now. It says okay, and so that's really all there is to it. There is no longer a need to put a fake check number in there. Okay. You also want to make sure when you're doing this that you put in the correct date paid. When you're doing a manual check in the old days, or even now, you know, that's probably the date that you're making the entry. When you were putting a check in to be printed by the system, it would make note of when it was paid. But now that you're doing EFTs, you need to be careful to, no longer do you have to put a check number in, but you have to make sure that the date paid is correct because that EFT may have gone out a couple days ago. It may be scheduled to go out in the future, and you want to make sure that you have the right thing going on there. The other thing that I want to point out then is that if we go into void posted checks EFTs, you now have the ability to say that I want to void a check or an EFT. And then when you choose EFT, instead of asking for a check number, it's just going to simply ask for a reference number. And there's one that I can void. And that's all there is to it. So the whole process has been cleaned up immensely by the fact that you can now simply state that an item in accounts payable is an EFT without having to kind of fake out the system to get it in there in such a way that it's represented as an EFT and is going to be something that's going to be easy to void later if that's necessary. Always been a problem. This simple addition to that screen, having that radio button allow you to designate it as an EFT has, in essence, solved all of those problems. And that is that. Next month, we're going to talk about reprinting and undoing multiples. Did you hear that? Multiples. A lot of people know we can reprint a single statement. We can undo a single updated statement. But a lot of people don't know that we can do multiples and that there are some things to know about that. So Mary Jo is going to take that topic. And I'm going to talk about client funds, which is something that's in Tabs and which is a lot like trust accounting, but not. And so I'm going to explain what it is, why it's different, how it's different, and what it means, what people use it for, because the people that need this question answered have no idea what it would be used for, so we're going to educate them. Of course, it wouldn't be a live attorney computer systems event if I did not take you to Google Chrome and then immediately go to attorneycomputersystems.com, if I can get my computer to react to me here. And remember, it's attorney computer systems. Did you notice that? That little S? Without this S here, you won't get to the right place. This is where you go for all of our video content. You can either hover over the word videos in our menu bar and choose from the list, or you can just click the word videos, which is what I've just done. And when you do that, you get to a screen that describes all of our recorded videos. We have 6 different titles. 4 of them are live events, and 2 of them are things that we record without a live studio audience, if you will. The 3 virtual user group meetings, you are currently in the Tabs virtual user group meeting. We also have 1 for Practice Master and 1 for World Docs. And my coffee pot webinars, they are all live. We all know what the VUGs are, the virtual user group meetings, because you're in one right now. The coffee pot webinars, I give one of these every month. I invite somebody in from a third party company that has a product that enhances or adds value to one of our core products, Tabs, Practice Master, World Docs, and have them explain their product, how it's priced, how it works, how it integrates, and we get to ask them questions. So that's what that is. We also have 2 pre-recorded titles. Mary Jo has her eBytes video series, and we have the Paul and Mary Jo show. They're kind of the same. The eBytes video series, Mary Jo records 3 of these every month, 1 on Tabs, 1 on Practice Master, 1 on World Docs. They're little, you know, neat features that we feel are A, important, and B, can be explained in 2 or 3 minutes. And that's where the eBytes title comes from. They're very short. They're 2 or 3 minute videos about really cool things that we can explain quickly. We also do release 1 Paul and Mary Jo show every month, and either I or Mary Jo will take a topic that's a little broader, has a little bit more depth to it, and those typically last 10, 15, sometimes 20 minutes, and we get into all the nuts and bolts and the nitty-gritty of whatever that more expanded topic is. I'm going to take you to the Tabs Virtual User Group Meetings page, just so you can see. All of these titles, when you get to their page, has their title and a little brief description of what it is. And then if it's a live event like the virtual user group meeting is, you will find information on the next event. So here's our April 29th, where I just told you that we were talking about client funds and reprinting and undoing multiples. We used to have links, don't have them anymore. We just have the form right here. So you fill in your information right here, hit the register button, and you're ready to go. One thing I'll tell you is if you see something that's interesting to you, but you know you're not going to be available when the live webinar is, register anyways. There's no problem. You're not hurting us by registering. You're not taking somebody else's seat, even though you know you're not going to attend. And that means that as soon as the recorded version is out of post-production, Patty will know that you're interested, because the first thing she does is she sends links to those recorded webinars right away to all the people who were registered, whether they attended or not. So that's your best way to get that as soon as possible. Just go ahead and register anyways. As we scroll down, we'll find recorded versions of everything we've done before in the Tabs3 Virtual User Group meeting. This is where we are right now, so that's actually currently in post-production. It'll be out and on the website in about a week or so. And then here we've got recorded versions of all the past months. We have somewhere between 800 and 900 videos on our website. We have a lot of content. We've been doing this for about 10 years. We record about 9 or 10 videos each month. So please come take advantage of these. They are here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. They're absolutely free of charge, and there's a lot of valuable information here. And so that is it for today. Everybody have a good rest of the day and a good rest of the month, and we will see you when it's a little bit warmer in April. Thanks. Bye-bye.